And over to you, Jörg.
Yeah, thank you very much, Martin. Jörg Bareig is here from Karlstad University in Sweden. And I have with me my colleague, Lars Olin. Lars, do you want to say hi?
Hi, everyone. I'm Lars. I don't know if you see me or I think I'm sharing my screen. Yeah.
Yeah.
Working as an education developer at Linköping University in Sweden.
And we will be presenting a course to you, going from one course to another on a, I almost want to say, global scale now, open network learning. You see the link there in the middle. Lars, maybe you can put in the link in the chat room as well. We call it a course, a community, an approach, a collaborative effort in, with a core team of organizers from Sweden. And you see our colleagues here, and you, most of you will know him, Alistair Creelman, who's I think here as well, or was here at least, and Maria Kvarnström and Lotta Objörnsson from different universities in Sweden. But it's actually a global effort. I'll get back to you. There's more partner universities involved in this course around the world, and it's an open course. And do I switch to the next slide here or wait? Yeah, now I'm getting the hang of it. My microphone was in front of it. So it is an open online course about open online teaching and learning. It's targeted to your regular teacher, a colleague at your university, but also pedagogical developers. And the librarians are often taking part in the course. Everyone really who would like to understand and experience open network learning. And when we talk about open network learning, we focus very much on problem-based learning. And the course is really designed around problem-based learning. And that's the main focus of the course, I'd say, and not as so much mainly on and openness. Maybe all the material is open there. You can participate in the course. Also, I'll get back to there's three different ways of participating. We'll tell you all about it in a second. But it's really a problem-based learning course online. And I just wanted to check with you guys, has anyone done problem-based learning in an online session here in the audience? If you want to just let us know in the chat. And how much you are aware of problem-based learning as well, how much we should go back into it and explain problem-based learning. If you could let us know in the chat, and we can adapt the presentation a little bit just to get a feel. All right. You can read all about it on the definition of problem-based learning, how we conceive it and interpret it on the course homepage. Maybe one of my colleagues can send and copy and paste in our definition. I don't have it at hand right now. Maybe Lars has it in a definition of this. Lars, you're maybe our PBL expert, really.
PBL, the core aspects of problem-based learning, it's really inquiring into real-world problems or challenges, and that you also have a lot of own responsibility and self-directed learning within the framework of also working with collaborative learning. So, I mean, working with small groups, small teams, inquiring into real-world problems, I would say, would be some kind of core of what we see problem-based learning is. And it's for us, it's not a method, it's rather a kind of an educational approach, and it needs to be designed into whole education.
Yeah, Excellent. We maybe have a chance to get more back to it at the end of the presentation. Just a quick history. This course is rather old, I'd say, and has its history in a course called Flexible Distance Online Learning, which has a connection also to the UK with where Chrissy and Lars started this course back in 2013, right? When the MOOC hype tipped off a little bit. This is where I got the first time in touch with the course and was a lurker within the course for many years until I joined it again a good 1.5 years ago to be part of the organizing committee. Since 2014, we run the course now under the name Open Network Learning. And it's, as I said, focused on teachers and educational developers. And without diving too much into the different topics, you can see them here. And if you just quickly read through the headings, I think most of you will get an understanding what we mean with these topics. The course is actually running right now, so we are in the top right corner, open learning, sharing, and openness. What a great coincidence. We had a tweet chat today simultaneously with the tweet chat in the conference. We try to get started in the course getting everyone set up technically. We run the course on a WordPress homepage, have a little bit community space built there, which I'll show you in a second, and ask everyone to set up a blog. For those of the participants who want it, can connect their blog to the course homepage, which we aggregate then into the central learning hub. All right. So how does this course work? There's three ways really of participating. The first group of participants, they are teachers or employed and faculty and staff at the partner universities. We have 12 to 15 partner universities for each term. The course runs twice a year. Each partner university sends a number of participants. Each university has six spots, to be honest, and to be specific. We call them the institutional participants. They are faculty at the partner universities. For each PBL group, which we have eight spots on, we also have then two spots open. For open learners, and they can be like you and me, how I started in 2013 in the course, like have no affiliation to the partner universities. We just open up the course for people who are really eager to join PBL session. And the third way of participating is as an independent learner. If you don't want to commit to a PBL group, which requires one to two live sessions each week, and you have to coordinate yourself with other participants in your PBL group and put like 6 to 8 hours on. If you just want to participate independently, we advise you to set up your blog and connect it and connect through the live sessions. We organize like webinars or tweet chats and during the blogs. So that's the three ways of participating. So you have the link there underneath it. Then you register either as an institutional learner at your partner university, at your own institution, or through a registration form we have here, or if you're an independent learner, you don't need to register at all. And then you get ready, and then we hit it off. To show you why we talk about a community, this is our international community of partner universities. A lot of Swedish universities who has this course as their competence development course for teacher training, We also have two universities from Finland and part of it. We have two universities or colleges from South Africa. We have a university from Germany, and I think we have a participants here as well in the audience. And yes, Victoria, hi, good to have you with us here as well. And then we have the National University of Singapore as well as part of one of the partner universities. And then we have on the right hand side, you see a lot of open learners, which come from all different parts around the world. And we mix those participants in PBL groups of 8 people, and each PBL group has 2 facilitators, a facilitator and a co-facilitator, who guide the team process and make sure, especially in the beginning, that the PBL group gets on with their work. And so an overview of the 12 weeks is like this. We have in the beginning the getting started week, and we have the connecting week, and then we have the topics. And now next week we have a reflection week where everyone can take a break and maybe reflect on the learning and take part. And in each topic, the structure looks like this. We introduce a scenario. That's the central part of the problem-based learning. The team gathers around the scenario, and which they together make sense of and focus on a problem they want to focus on. So it's participant driven, really, what they want to focus on. The PBL group would meet twice a week then, and to share their own investigations and to collaborate and present then at the end of the week their PBL group, which is the blue arrow, which they share back into to the other PBL groups in the larger community. So for this, for the larger community, from all participants, and there are around 100 participants in the course, so it's not a massive open online course, so we have a community space where people can share some other resources, ask questions, like a discussion forum. I'll show you in a second. Then each PBL group has their own PBL group space for discussion and to a place to share their collaborative documents and find the collaborative documents we provide with them. And then they have their individual studies as part of the PBL group work, but also as part of blogging and commenting on other blog posts and connecting with others. And we ask them to comment on each other's blogs, obviously, to get this connected learning going on outside the PBL groups as well. So if you go to all blog posts in the menu, then you see like all the blog posts. If you're keen to take care of and take part of the reflections going on, we have right now 65 blogs connected. We don't require this. This is completely up to the participants to connect their blog. A lot of them use this, make use of this option. And then we have like for the last 3 iterations where we started with the aggregation, we have like more than 1,000 syndicated posts, which is pretty cool. And that's really the possibility for independent learners to connect to the others here. And so this is the community space from last year here. That's a plot by a lot of you will know him, Tom Woodward. He designed this space. It's, as I said, a WordPress page. Some of you might recognize it. Looks familiar if you use Google Plus. And Tom built, redesigned it, a template from the Google Plus design, which is kind of neat, and it's readily available out there as well on Tom's or Alt VCU's GitHub page. for easy sharing here, just like finishing up the presentation shortly, just going to show you quick numbers. So we've been running this course since 2014 and still going strong. We kind of have a sustainable model. We're getting more and more participants getting certified or, which we, if you fulfill the requirements and with the blogging and commenting and actively participate in the PBI certificate, so you see the numbers. It's again not massive, but a steady growth of O&Lers, which a lot of them come back and be part join as part facilitators or co-facilitators afterwards. So I'm just not a scientific course evaluation, but from the final webinar, from the one of the last iterations here, some words where participants described the course in one word. So it's a lot of fun and collaboration and inspiring. You see also words as one tiny word was frustrating here somewhere in the left, I think, as well. It is can be confusing and frustrating. Maybe not as frustrating and confusing how a CMOOC can be. So this is where we think that part comes in, where the PBL groups also work in a closed environment. It's not open, because we want to introduce slowly participants to the concept and idea of openness, which is very new to a lot of the participants. But it's a good fun, and it's an inspiring and collaborative process. So the next iteration, if you want to start from scratch from the beginning with it, then we would gladly welcome you in the 14th of September, where we kick off the next iteration. It's 12 weeks until the 6th of December. So hope to see you there, or on our current hashtag ONL201. All right. I think, did I miss anything else?
There seems to be some minutes left. Any questions or ideas about this?
I think you've done a wonderful time job keeping your time, and I think as well you've an excellent job tag teaming the questions in the Q&A, but in the chat, sorry, but if anyone would like to ask a question, please feel free to either raise your hand or put it in the chat and we can pick it up.
Yeah, otherwise, thanks.
And I think there's an open invitation. We were striving to be an international collaboration with this course. So anyone interested, just contact any of us.
Yeah, and I forgot to mention, we had we had Dave White also for one of the topics. So if you're ever keen to want to join in and present in one of the webinars during the topic, also feel free to contact us. And we got a question. I'm still wondering why.
I think Gavi's question is about if there are any costs. I mean, the whole idea with the course is collaboration and between institutions. And that's why we moved quite a lot outside universities. So it's a collaborative project where everyone contributes with resources and facilitation in the course. So each institution uses this common course as a course in their own institution. So they make certificate to NSS their own participants in the course. So what we really offering here is an arena, I think, for institutions to collaborate, and it shouldn't be any costs involved in that, unless more than what each institution contributes with this collaborative project.
Each university contributes with the time of the facilitators, and the rest is a community project, and it's like like and the development for the each university.
I think one thing that's fantastic, you mentioned co-facilitators and our previous participants, and we have a lot of previous participants that still want to continue with contributing in the course and being part of the community. So, I mean, that's open network learning. It's about community building and networking. Once you join that and feel the community, you don't want to quit it. So you want to stay. And so that's why the community is growing, I think.
Yeah, that's...
So please let us know if you're interested.
Yeah, thanks, Gabby, for the feedback. Let's talk more. And I think you knew Alistair as well, I guess. So we'd be happy to connect. Excellent. So thanks a lot for having us.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. A lot for our audience to take away. So if we could just thank all our presenters for their sessions today in this slot. We're actually, if you want to hang around, we're actually doing the close of OER20 in this